Good day. It's cold outside here today, and we had freezing rain on top of some snow, and so there's a glaze over the land. Very slippery, very cold. I can't wait to see the end of winter. In fact, I love to get back to Africa. In Accra, the temperature's probably, 32 degrees, 35 degrees or so. And while that seems hot, it would be very inviting right now. Speaking of Africa, of course, there is a town called Paga, P-A-G-A. And it is in Ghana, West Africa. And it's nestled right up to against the border of Burkina Faso, to the north of it. And it is where they have this, what they call the sacred pond of crocodiles. And they believe that the crocodiles hold the souls of villagers in the area that are deceased. And even some very high profile deaths in the area have corresponded to the deaths of some of these very large crocodiles. Now, ancestors' souls or not, the crocodiles of this sacred pond in Paga are protected and allegedly as safe and domesticated as pets. Now, I don't know if I would agree with that after seeing some things that I've seen, but the residents of Paga certainly treat them as such, and they regularly interact with them. There is about, or are, about 110 crocodiles in the major pond they call Chief's Pond there. And so, of course, there I was with my three companions and by the water in Paga on Chief's Pond, holding on to live chickens that were squawking and flapping that we had just purchased from a vendor when we entered into this sanctuary. We were on our way to Ouagadougou, which is the capital of Burkina Faso, and that was an interesting time in that place as well. But right now, here we were by the pond with these live chickens in our hands and a dozen or so crocodiles swimming towards us, and some starting to climb out of the water onto the shore. And it was a little nervous, a little unsettling at first, because some of these creatures were very, very, very large. We had an opportunity, of course, to interact with the crocodiles that day and even sit on one. I do have the picture somewhere. One of my colleagues was sitting up on a tall ridge, maybe 20 feet up or so, that was close to the pond. And I said, you know, aren't you going to come down and, you know, be with the crocodiles and such? And he was sitting up there and he said, I can imagine that this is what the crocodile might be thinking. You know what? The next person that sits on my back, I'm going to eat for supper. And so, and he may have been right, but he stayed up on the ridge that day. For the first little while that we were there, we had an opportunity to watch the behavior of the crocodiles. One of the locals took one of these live chickens and threw it into the water as far out as they could. And these crocodiles would then, I mean, it was, wasn't pretty, but the crocodiles would then fight over the chicken and do all kind. I mean, the water was churning up with all this frenzy of trying to get this chicken, and the one that finally got it, and we watched it chew it and swallow it down whole, which was interesting. And then this big, huge crocodile wandered out of the water, and one of the locals at the sanctuary took one of our other live chickens that we had and put it on a, tied the feet on a string. And I know what you're thinking, but, you know, and had it on a long pole, off the end of a long pole, and held it up high in the air. And this crocodile, this immense crocodile, leaped about 6 or 7 feet in the air to grab at this chicken. Now, I never in my wildest imagination would think, because you'd always think, you know, if you could just get up 2 or 3 feet, or, you know, maybe even 6 feet above a crocodile, you'd be safe, right, on a piece of land. I never thought that anything that big with such short legs could leap so high into the air. And it was quite a warning for me. Well, at one point, as I already have the picture I've told you about, I had this opportunity to sit on the back of this very same crocodile that had leaped some 6-7 feet in the air and had a chance to grab this huge tail and lift it up. And so I got, you know, several pictures taken. And I did so, I think, because I thought, when am I ever going to have another chance to be in this area or to be this close to all these crocodiles and have a chance to interact with this reptile in this way? Brings me to our scripture today, which we've used before, but it's very appropriate, I think, especially for the things that are going on today. And the scripture simply reads, this is Proverbs chapter 27 and verse 12. And it simply reads this way: the prudent man sees evil and hides himself. The naive proceed and pay the penalty. And it could easily be, easily have read, the prudent woman sees evil and hides herself. The naive proceed and they pay the penalty. The Bible tells you and me that evil can be foreseen, that we have the ability to discern, or other people around us to discern, or get the sense that something's not right, that there is danger, darkness, and evil on the horizon, and it can be foreseen. It says, the Bible says, that where there is temptation, and that's easy, it's easy to foresee that if we thrust ourselves in towards that temptation, that there will be sin, and more easily to see or foresee that if we jump in on that sin, that there's going to be evil that follows that sin. And what follows evil is usually, if we're not careful, punishment of some description. And God warns us before that punishment comes. Now, there's a passage here in Jeremiah chapter 6 and verses 17, but I want to start a little before that. And Jeremiah is sort of talking about the destruction of Jerusalem because of the evil, because of the disobedience of the people. I'm going to start reading in 16 here. I'm going to read right down to 21 perhaps. Thus says the Lord, stand by the ways and see and ask for the ancient paths where the good way is, and walk in it, and you will find rest for your souls. Sounds like good advice to me. But they said, the people, we will not walk in it. God, I will set a watchman over you, saying, listen to the sound of the trumpet. But they said, we won't listen. Therefore, hear, O nations, and know, O congregation, what is among them. Hear, O earth, before I am bringing disaster on this people, the fruit of their plans, because they have not listened to my words. And as for my law, they have rejected it also. For what purpose does frankincense come to me from Sheba, and the sweet cane from distant land? Your burnt offerings are not acceptable, and your sacrifices are not pleasing to me. Therefore, thus says the Lord, behold, I'm laying a stumbling block before the people, and they will stumble against them. Fathers and sons together, neighbors and friends, will perish. And what God is saying is, I have a path for you. I have a wisdom for you. I have a life for you. And you need to listen to me. And if you listen to me, there, as it says here, you will find rest for your souls if you walk on the path that is good. But so many people do not. Let's, for instance, change evil for crocodile. It will be well and ill with us according as we do not sort of improve our foresight of evil, our foresight of the crocodile, and hide ourselves like my friend on the ridge that day. But a simple like me either is so dull or so disobedient that I would disobey or not foresee the danger and evil that is coming and take no action to avoid it. And so if I were to continue, I would proceed onto something that could be very dangerous, and I may be punished in some way for that. Now, obviously, that day in Pega by Chief's Pond, looked like a small lake, big pond, obviously I survived, or I wouldn't be talking to you today. This many years later, but having witnessed what the crocodile's behaviors were like, having witnessed what the crocodile was capable of that I didn't know before, I still sat on it. I could have foreseen the evil. Remember, a prudent man sees evil and hides himself, and then I proceed and pay the penalty. I could have foreseen the evil, foreseen the danger, and not sat on it, but I did. And because of that, I could have been, because these are wild animals, I could have been maimed or killed. And that's just the truth. And isn't that like most of us today in life? We seek out the danger. We find it when we seek it out. We see it and observe it, and sometimes even pay to play with the danger. We witness what the danger is capable of, and like the proverb warns, naively proceed and potentially pay a penalty for our carelessness. Now, today, knowing the danger and having witnessed in the news what the danger is capable of, namely death, do you still go into a public space without a mask? Or do you still go into a public space and wear the mask down below your nose, which accomplishes absolutely nothing. Because who are these people to tell you what you can and cannot do? Who are they to tell you that you must wear a mask in public in the middle of this pandemic that doesn't seem to be easing up very much? And if you think about this, what other kinds of unhealthy things, evil things, unhealthy people, potentially evil people, unhealthy thoughts, potentially evil thoughts, situations, temptations that might lead to sinful temptations, do you hear about and witness and foresee and still jump on their backs? Was I foolish for the experience of a photo op in Africa that time? Or just trying to have the thrill of an experience like no other? Sitting on a very large reptile that could easily have turned on, and they are fast, boy. They're fast. Who could have easily turned on me and harm me, and maybe fatally. Was I foolish? Was I naive? Maybe. I don't know. So I think in all of this, you need to ask yourself this question today. And it's very simple. What are you thinking of sitting on? What are you thinking of sitting on? And ask yourself this as well. Will I pay the price for doing it? Good questions, I think. Father, thank you for this day, even though it's frightfully cold. Be with all those that are listening to this devotional. And Lord, help us to foresee the dangers. Help us to foresee the evil. Help us not to be naive about what we are doing, what we think will be, not cause us any problems, but could turn out to kill us. Father, give us that discernment and help us not to be foolish, Lord. There are so many dangers today, Father, lurking out there for each and every one of us. And if we are careless or just ignore your advice or your voice, punishment is headed our way. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. I think would not be difficult to foresee some situations or some problems, some places you shouldn't walk into, some things you should not do, some situations or people you know you should avoid. You should be able to foresee trouble that could potentially harm you. And some of it, like walking around with this virus out there, and especially the new variants that are very highly transmissible and dangerous, or sitting on a crocodile, or other things. I mean, you can see where the danger is, and you really need to make a choice. You know, what am I going to do? What is reasonable, or what is naive? Because your naivety can get you into a lot of trouble. And so be very careful these days. Be very careful. The prudent person, man, woman, child, sees and foresees evil and hides themselves, which I think is not such a bad thing. But the naive, the foolish, the unthinking, the unlistening, those that don't discern proceed, and they potentially pay the penalty for that. A great time, of course, to pick up the telephone and call someone, especially on this cold day, or it might be very hot, and tell them that they're not alone, they're not abandoned, they're not forgotten, that they are loved. Not just by God, but by you and by so many others. Give them that comfort. Remind them of this devotional if they haven't seen it, that, you know, we can blindly walk into something that, you know, remember sin. I love this definition of sin. Sin will take you where you don't want to go, keep you there longer than you want to stay, and cost you much more than you're willing to pay. If you just remind them of those simple words, that's love, isn't it? That's love. I want us these days to be praying for those that are suffering because of the weather, and right now I'm thinking about those in Texas, down in the south, maybe even parts of Louisiana, where snow and ice is falling, where electricity's failed, where water has failed to reach people, burst pipes, people are dying of exposure. They really need your prayers. They, you know, whether they are in Africa or Asia or South America or other parts of Canada or in Texas right now, our sisters and brothers need our prayers. And so we need to be about the business of doing just that. May God guide you and protect you. May God allow you to foresee the problems and avoid them. May He keep you safe and love you until we meet again. Amen. Now, I'm going to go out there, but I'm going to put a scarf on first that my wife made. It's warm, and a jacket and gloves and hat and everything else. And so prepare yourself, whether it's with sunscreen and a hat for shade, or whether it's a warm jacket and scarf and gloves and hat and everything else. Go out there and have the very best day that you can, I think, is what God would want for you. Brr. Oh, man, it's cold. I'm telling you. Oh, yeah. I'm ready. Are you? Have a good one.